Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel, Dr. Bhakya's Ophthalmology Tutorials. Today we will continue with the cataract surgery practical aspects. In the previous video, I have covered everything about the cataract classification, the types of cataract, various stages of the maturation of cataract, how to differentiate between immature, mature and hypermature cataract. Okay, so in this video, we will continue with the cataract surgeries and the complications of cataract surgery. Let's come to the types of cataract surgery. In the cataract surgeries, we have two main types, that is intracapsular cataract extraction and extracapsular cataract extraction. So the first question that will be asked is, what is the major difference between intracapsular cataract extraction and the extracapsular? In the intracapsular cataract extraction, you are removing the whole lens along with the posterior capsule. Okay, so the lens along with the posterior capsule is removed in the intracapsular, whereas in the extracapsular, if you take this as lens, and this is the posterior capsule. Here you are leaving behind the posterior capsule and a rim of the anterior capsule. The rest of the lens part is taken out. Okay, so that is the difference between ICCE and the ECCE. So there are very few indications for intracapsular cataract surgery now. The indications are like, if there is gross subluxation. Okay, remember, if it is very gross subluxation only. If it is of mild subluxation, again the ECCE preferred. Only when there is gross subluxation of the lens or the dislocation of the lens, okay, then we go for intracapsular cataract extraction. So coming to the extracapsular cataract surgery, in this we have conventional ECCE, small incision cataract surgery and phaco emulsification. So let's see each one by one now. So here, nowadays the conventional ECCE is also not done. The surgeries which are done nowadays are either small incision cataract surgery or the phaco emulsification. So let me explain the steps of small incision cataract surgery. Then in between I will be telling the difference between the conventional ECCE and the small incision cataract surgery. So coming to the steps of the small incision cataract surgery, the first one is the anesthesia. Which type of anesthesia is used? It is usually the local anesthesia, that is in the form of peribulbar block or the retrobulbar block. So these are the two forms of anesthesia which are commonly used for SACS. Next question is, the other types of anesthesia which are used for cataract surgery. You can also say the topical anesthesia, which is used in case of phaco emulsification, and also there is something called as posterior septinous anesthesia, okay, which can be used both in SACS as well as phaco emulsification. This is the eyeball which is situated in the orbital cavity. So this eyeball is surrounded by, as you know, the extraocular muscles, the details of which I have covered in my squint videos on extraocular muscles. You can go through that video. So the eyeball is covered by the extraocular muscles, forming a space here. Okay, so the eyeball is held like this and the extraocular muscles are forming a space there. That is called as the intraconal space. Okay, which is there within the extraocular muscles. There is one more space between this extraocular muscle and the bony orbit. So this space is called as extraconal space. So in the peribulbar and the retrobulbar block, we are using the lignocaine, okay, as or the bupivacaine. This is mixed with the hyaluronidase, okay, hyaluronidase, which is an enzyme which will aid in the penetration of these drugs into the ocular tissue. So here, the peribulbar and the retrobulbar block, we are using these anesthetic agent. In peribulbar block, the 5 cc of this mixture is placed in this extraconal space. This anesthetic agent is divided into 3 ml and 2 ml. The 3 ml of anesthetic agent is injected through the superior part of this extraconal space, whereas the 2 ml is injected into the inferior extraconal space, and then the firm massage is given over the closed eyelids, and that aids in the diffusion of the anesthetic agent and thereby achieving the anesthesia. So the anesthesia here, what is achieved is the akinesia, that is loss of movements and loss of pain or loss of sensation of touch. Okay, so in the retrobulbar space, the anesthetic agent is injected into this intraconal space. Okay, so here only the 2 to 3 ml of anesthetic agent is sufficient. So directly it is injected into the intraconal space and thereby on achieving the anesthesia. It's between the peribulbar and the retrobulbar anesthesia is, in peribulbar, as I told, the space is extraconal, whereas in the retrobulbar the space is intraconal. Here at least 5 to 6 ml of anesthetic agent is used, whereas in retrobulbar it is only 2 to 3 ml of anesthetic agent. Anesthesia which is achieved in retrobulbar is very quick compared to your peribulbar, whereas the complications like injury to the optic nerve, okay, and injury to the globe are more with the retrobulbar compared to your peribulbar block. So in topical anesthesia, paracaine eye drops are instilled into the conjunctival sac and that will achieve the anesthesia. Here only the loss of sensation is achieved, okay, the ocular movements are still present. In subtenons, again the same anesthetic agent of lignocaine or bupivacaine 2 ml around is taken, and after making a conjunctival flap and pocket, the anesthetic agent is injected into the subtenon space. So this is about the anesthesia which is used. I have told very briefly only for the practical purpose. So coming to the steps of small incision cataract surgery. So after the anesthesia is achieved, the patient is made to lie down on the operating table. The eye to be operated is painted and draped. After that, the universal eye speculum is placed. Okay. Eye speculum is placed and the eyelids are retracted. First step is placing the bridle suture. What is bridle suture? You are just holding the superior rectus muscle here with the superior rectus forceps. Okay. And then pass the thread below this superior rectus muscle and it is secured. So it has two purposes. One is it will place the eyeball in down gaze, thereby helping in more space to operate here. And the second advantage is it will stabilize the globe. Then we make a conjunctival flap. Okay, this the conjunctiva and the tenons are separated from the sclera. So if you take this, so this is the right eye of the patient. So here the surgeon will be sitting and here the conjunctival flap is made. Like this the conjunctiva is averted back. So this is called as the fornix based conjunctival flap, since it is attached at the fornix and that is the base. So it is called as fornix based conjunctival flap. The one more is the limbal based conjunctival flap, where we are opening here in the fornicial conjunctiva and it is turned over the cornea. So after doing the conjunctival flap, incision is placed, okay, over the sclera. Incision is placed over the sclera. So the size of the incision will be different in your conventional ECCE and the small incision cataract surgery. In conventional ECCE, it is more around 8 to 10 mm in conventional ECCE, whereas in small incision cataract surgery, it is almost 5.5 to 7 mm of partial thickness scleral incision is placed. So that is the length of that. So it is 1.5 to 2 mm away from the limbus. Okay. So this partial thickness scleral incision is made, followed by the making of tunnel. So that the tunnel is nothing but we are creating a groove here in the layers of the sclera. The depth of the tunnel is one third to half of the sclera is entered and you are creating a groove here, and then you will be entering the limbal area and then continuing with the dissection into the cornea. So this is the tunnel which is made. So in the cornea it is 1 to 1.5 mm into the anterior surface of the cornea. So this is the tunnel. The speciality of this tunnel is it is a self-sealing tunnel. Okay. So how it becomes self-sealing, I will explain later. So after the tunnel is made, the side pocket is created in the anterior chamber. After that, stain the anterior capsule with the dye, that is the tryptophan blue dye is used to stain the anterior capsule, and then it is washed out with the normal saline again. Then inject the visco with the same side port and form the anterior chamber. After this step, you are doing the entry here. Means, so I will show this now here in this diagram. So what you had done now, so this is the scleral incision, partial thickness scleral incision. So that will be like this, if you see in this diagram. So this is the partial thickness scleral incision. So this tunnel what you have made here will come like this. Okay. So this is the partial thickness scleral and corneal, that is sclerocorneal tunnel. Then when you enter the anterior chamber at this point, so it will be entered like this. So finally, you are having a zigzag shaped corneal sclerotic tunnel, which is self-sealing. Okay, so once the posterior surface comes into the contact of the anterior surface, this will seal by itself. So there is no question of leak if it is a good tunnel. So then the entry is made throughout this part, and now we are in the anterior chamber. After this, the process of opening the lens capsule, that is, so this is the lens. We have the anterior capsule and the posterior capsule all over this lens. So now you are removing this part of the anterior capsule. There are various techniques for this removal of the anterior capsule. So if you take this, so this is the anterior lens capsule, then if you will just give a nick in the center and make a flap, and then remove this whole of the anterior capsule in a continuous fashion. Okay, so this is called as CCC, or continuous curvilinear capsulorhexis. The second one is, this is the lens with anterior capsule. You are making multiple nicks and opening up the anterior capsule. So this is called as can opener technique. There is one more technique called as the envelope technique, which is usually done in case of hypermature cataracts. So this is the anterior capsule. You just give a horizontal incision like this and open the anterior capsule. The liquefied cortex will come out, followed by the Morgagnon lens or the nuclear sclerotic lens, which is there, will also come out from this. Then you extend the opening of this anterior capsule and complete the surgery. So after doing the can opener, so this part of the anterior capsule is removed. So now you are left with the posterior capsule, a rim of the anterior capsule, and the lens material. So now you have to inject the fluid, that is called as hydrodissection. So where exactly it is injected? Just below the anterior capsule. Okay, so it is injected below the capsule. So it is in between the lens capsule and the lens. This is called as hydrodissection. There is one more technique called as hydrodelineation, where you are injecting the fluid between the lens cortex and the nucleus. So this is called as hydrodelineation. Okay, so in case of posterior polar cataracts, where you are expecting a dehiscence or the weakness of the posterior capsule, you are not disturbing this part of the cortex. So to leave behind a plate of cortex like this, so as to prevent the damage to the posterior capsule, you are injecting the fluid between the lens cortex and the nucleus. That procedure is called as hydrodelineation. So once the hydrodissection or delineation is done, you rotate the nucleus and then take this into the anterior chamber. So the lens which was lying here, now will flip into the anterior chamber. This is taken out through the tunnel by various methods. There are two commonly used methods, that is wire vectis method, and one more is with the irrigation vectis method. Okay. So in wire vectis, what we do, the lens which is there in the anterior chamber, now the vectis instrument is passed behind this, and anteriorly the Sinski hook is placed and the lens is held firmly and taken out. Whereas in case of irrigating vectis, the vectis has the irrigation port like this, so it will be pushing the fluid around the lens and the lens is taken out. So now the lens is delivered out of the eyeball. Now we are left with few of the cortical matter here in the capsular bag. So that is washed out by using irrigation aspiration method. So for the irrigation aspiration method, we have a three-port cannula like thing. Okay, so here it is the aspiration port, on either side it will have a irrigating port. So from here the fluid keeps on coming and the aspiration is done from the main port. So in that way the whole of the loose cortex is removed out. After this, again place the viscoelastic and place the intraocular lens into the bag. So after all this procedure, what is left? You are just left with the rim of the anterior capsule along with the posterior capsule. So the intraocular lens is placed in the bag like this. Okay, so now the intraocular lens is placed. After that, again wash the remaining viscoelastic material and hydrate the side port. Give the subconjunctival injection, okay, into the conjunctival flap which was there. The subconjunctival injection consists of the antibiotic and the steroid injection. Okay, so that will take care of the immediate inflammation as well as the infection. So this is about the cataract surgery step. So the main difference with the conventional and SICS is, in conventional we are making a scleral incision of 8 to 10 mm. So it is not self-sealing. So here we have to place the sutures. So here it is sutured in case of conventional ECCE, whereas in SACS is self-sealing type of tunnel. And the complications like supracoroidal hemorrhages are more with the conventional ECCE compared to your SACS. So coming to the steps of phacoemulsification, steps are less in case of phacoemulsification compared to your SACS. Here the anesthesia which is used is usually the topical anesthesia. It can also be done under retro or peribulbar block. The initial steps are like the patient is again made to lie down in the operating table. So this is the right eye of the patient and the surgeon will be sitting here. Again the universal eye speculum is placed. The conjunctiva is given a wash. Clear corneal incision is made. Okay, directly the incision, which is a trapezoid shaped incision, is made, which is around 2.8 to 3 mm of incision is made. And then the anterior chamber is entered. The side ports are made again. Two side ports are made. Then the steps of staining the anterior capsule and doing the rexis are same. But here the rexis is must compared to your SACS, where you can do even the can opener technique. But here the rexis is compulsory. So the anterior capsule is open and then the hydro dissection is done and the lens is rotated. After that the phaco probe is passed here. Phaco emulsification probe will emulsify the nucleus and it will aspirate the content. After that again the wash is given from the two ports here. So the cortex which are there again are removed and then the intraocular lens is placed using a injector. Okay, and then finally just hydrate the wounds. That will complete the procedure of your phaco emulsification. So this is in brief about the steps of small incision cataract surgery as well as the phaco emulsification. Phaco emulsification, as I told, it is done under topical anesthesia. You can also use the laser energy. So this laser will help in doing some of the steps of the phaco surgery which I explained just now. Like it will help in making corneal incision. Okay, we'll first give a plane here. A plane of dissection is done by using the femto laser. The main incision, the side ports, even the capsular axis is done. Then by using your other instruments, then you can go ahead with the phaco surgery as I told. So that is using femto laser in phaco emulsification. So what are the advantages of small incision cataract surgery over phaco? In small incision cataract surgery, the learning curve is very less, one thing. So most of the ophthalmologists are well versed with the SACS. Okay, the instruments used are less costly. So whenever you want to do in bulk, in like in case of CAMS, you can go for small incision cataract surgery. But the disadvantage of SACS is it will induce some amount of astigmatism because we have done a sclerocorneal tunnel which was measuring 5.5 to 7 mm. It will leave behind astigmatism once it heals. So that is the advantage with the phaco emulsification. There is no or very minimal astigmatism in case of phaco emulsification. But the cost of machine is high and the learning curve is also very high. The complications which occur in phaco, like the lens drop, are little difficult to manage. So they are the advantages of phaco emulsification compared to SACS. So next, moving on to the complications of cataract surgery. The most commonly asked is small incision cataract surgery. Intraoperative complications, early postoperative complications and late postoperative complications. In the intraoperative complications, the complications you can expect right from the block. So as I told, in case of retrobulbar block, the chance of injury to the optic nerve is there. The chance of blow perforation are there. So coming to the next step, that is when you place the bridle suture, you can still injure the superior rectus muscle. Okay, with the bridle suture, you can be injuring the superior rectus muscle or you can even perforate the globe. When you come to making tunnel, so it can be just a superficial tunnel. So that will form button hole. Then you will have to leave that plane and go deeper and take a next plane. But if it becomes deep, there are chances of premature entry. So as I explained in this picture, so this is the entry which we are planning, that is the normal entry. In case of premature entry, this tunnel is little deep, so we will be directly entering the anterior chamber and it will create a two planar incision rather than three plane incision. Okay, that is the complication with your step of tunnel. Then when you are entering the anterior chamber, you may damage the desmoid's membrane leading to desmoid's membrane detachment. That can happen even with your side port also. Then the next complication is with your rexis. So this rexis can be either small rexis, or it may become a very big rexis, or it is centrically placed rexis. It need not be in the center, or even there can be runoff of the rexis. So these are the complications with rexis. And when you are removing the lens matter, you may injure the posterior capsule leading to PC rent or the posterior capsular rent. When there is posterior capsular rent, the structure which is there behind is the vitreous. So vitreous can herniate through this rent and come into the anterior chamber. And then the procedure is, you should do vitrectomy, and then depending upon the capsule which is left, you should plan for further lens implantation. So if it is very small rent, then you can do vitrectomy and place the PC IVL only, or you can place the PC IVL in the sulcus. So what is sulcus? So this, so here you have the iris. So in this space you can place the intraocular lens instead of placing it in the posterior chamber, or you can go for anterior chamber IVL here, or even the iris fixated IVL. So depending upon the PC status, you will decide which type of lens you want. And one more complication with the conventional ECC, as I told, it is the expulsive choroidal hemorrhage, commonly seen in case of hypertensive patients. Because of the suprachoroidal hemorrhage, the wound which you have created may open up by itself, and the all the contents of the eye keep on coming out. So it is a devastating complication of the conventional extracapsular cataract surgery. A few intraoperative complications. The main one is the PC rent and the vitreous loss. Okay. In case of phacoemulsification, as you go on doing the phaco, like when the phaco probe is emulsifying the lens, there may be PC rent, and this hole of the lens can drop into the vitreous cavity. So this is called as lens drop or the nucleus drop. Okay. So these are the intraoperative complications. Coming to early postoperative, we have the hyphema, that is blood in the anterior chamber. So when you have done the sclerocoronary tunnel, if you have injured the iris tissue, you may have blood in the anterior chamber. Depending upon the amount of the blood in the anterior chamber, the treatment varies again. Even there can be corneal edema postoperatively. Okay, that is also called as striate keratopathy. Corneal edema can be because of either injury to the desmoid's membrane or the endothelial loss, or it can be because of the raised intraocular pressure. So depending upon that, you should treat. If it is secondary to raised intraocular pressure, give anti-glaucoma medications and reduce the IOP. If you suspect endothelial injury, again give anti-glaucoma medication so that the remaining endothelial cells will take care of the corneal edema. The next complication is, there can be uveitis or the inflammation of the iris tissue. Usually there will be mild amount of uveitis, but if it is more, you should treat with a higher dosage of, with a stronger steroids. Okay, even the early bacterial endophthalmitis can be a postoperative complication. So just for the practical purpose, remember these names and how to manage these cases. Coming to the late postoperative complication, the two major postoperative complications are cystoid macular edema and the after cataract, also called as PCO or the posterior capsular opacification. And one more is the pseudophakic bullous keratopathy or the aphakic bullous keratopathy. So in the cystoid macular edema, there is edema in the macular region. Usually this will follow in case of eventful surgeries where there is disturbance for the vitreous. So if there is vitreous loss, the chance of CME are more, and even in case of diabetic patients, the chance of CME are more, and the younger age group patients. These patients will be having good vision up to 1 or 2 months after surgery. After that, there will be sudden blurring, or after that there will be sudden decrease in the vision. So that's how the patient presents with CME. So it is treated with NSAID drops, okay, or even the intravitreal steroid injections. Okay, the next complication is PCO or the posterior capsular opacification. So it is a separate topic by itself, so it can be asked even for your 5-mark question. So what is the pathophysiology behind this PCO is? So as you know, As I told just now, there is a rim of anterior capsule which is left behind to create a pocket to place the intraocular lens. So there are cells here. These cells are called as epithelial cells. So these cells are actively dividing throughout our life. So these cells keep on dividing and form the lens fibers which go and accumulate behind your IOL. Okay. So this will form an opacity. So this is called as posterocapsular opacification. And in this we have three types. Sommering rings. The second one is Elshring's pearls. Dense membranous after cataract. So if it is Sommering rings, so it will form a ring like structure here. It will proliferate in this fashion. So central visual axis is still clear. So for this there is no need of any treatment because the ring which is formed is not obstructing the visual axis. In Elshring's pearls, these are tiny drop like thing will be present over the posterior capsule. So this needs treatment with the YAG laser. This is called as ND YAG laser. Okay. And for the dense membranous PCO, you have to do membranectomy, means you have to intervene surgically and remove this part of the posterior capsule. The next complication is the PBK or the pseudophakic bullous keratopathy. This occurs when your endothelium has not regenerated after the surgery. So the endothelium decompensation will be there and there will be corneal edema with a bullae formation. Okay, so this is about the PBK or the pseudophakic bullous keratopathy. This can even occur when the lens is left aphakic. That is called as aphakic bullous keratopathy. Even there can be late endophthalmitis also. Okay, so these are the complications of the cataract surgery. So in next video, I will be discussing about the aphakia as well as the pseudophakia. So I have just covered the surgery from the practical point of view. Means in case of practicals, what are the expected questions I have answered here. Hope this video on the cataract surgeries is useful to all of you. If you like my videos, please do subscribe to my channel. Press the bell icon for further notifications. Please do like and share my videos. Thank you so much.